This chapter is about the impact of problems and information on the financial industry. For example, adverse selection. Does this sound familiar, perhaps in another course, adverse selection? What is it all about? So, the basic problem is that one agent does not have as much information about what has happened as the other agent, and therefore the well-informed agent is able to take advantage of the uninformed agent. So here's an example. People say that adverse selection is due to an asymmetry of information, but all that we really mean is that one person knows more than the other person. The uninformed agent they do things that are detrimental for her. So here's an example. You sell health insurance, but you don't know which of your clients are truly ill and which clients are not. So you charge everybody the same premium. But for instance, you have, let's say, two clients. One is healthy, and the other is not. The cost of illness is, let's say, $1,000. All right, so the expected cost in this case for each client, or let's say there's a 100% chance that one client is healthy, column A, and a 100% chance that the other client, column B, is not healthy. So the expected cost of illness to you is 50% of 1,000. Or 500. So because you face competition, you cannot increase the premium beyond $500. So that is the premium that you are charging for each client. Now A won't pay that premium. Because he knows that he's going to be healthy this year. They will be happy to pay the premium because he knows that he will be ill in this year. The certificate and without insurance, he will have to pay $1,000. The result to you, the insurer, you will lose your healthy client. Consequently, you collect a premium only from D, and you will have to pay $1,000. In exchange for the premium, we must pay $1,000. Christine will surely be ill this year. And thus, your lack of information about A and B will cause you to lose money. And you might even have to exit the insurance industry. So in short, adverse selection endangers your firm. So that's one possible problem. Notice that it arises from conditions that were assumed even before the insurance contract. Now, another problem of information, again, due to in the symmetry, one person knows more than the other, is moral hazard. In this case, the contract between the agents will induce behavior that prompts one agent. Adverse selection, on the other hand, had resulted from circumstances before the contract. So, choosing an example, out of the smoke, in bed. Although there is a risk that I will fall asleep with the cigarette and consequently it burned down my house. So without insurance, I take this risk into account and maybe I will forego the pleasure of smoking in bed. The proof is dead that I have 100% insurance against my bringing down the house. And indeed, the insurer will pay the full cost of my lost house. In that event, smoking in bed and pulsing does not cost me anything except the premium. So I am more likely to smoke in bed with the insurance than without it. In other words, the insurance has induced me to do something that is detrimental for the insurer. That is more hazard. All right, on the two main problems of information that people talk about in chapter 8, adverse selection and more hazard. If so, then let's go ahead and look at a couple of problems due to the asymmetry of information. Here is one. I call it the lazy broker's paradise. But the idea is that you have a broker in thin tent who you're not able to monitor all the time. So how productive he is depends on his mood. Sometimes he is lazy. Sometimes just hard working. However, he may be able to choose which mood he will operate under. If he is lazy, then there is a 60% chance that he will earn $10,000 for you. And a 40% chance that he will earn $50,000 instead. On the other hand, if she's her working, there is only a 20% chance that people earn as little as $10,000, and an 80% chance that people work very hard for you. However, if they work hard, which he hates to do, people incur a cost of $1,000 of disutility. So let's take a look at what may be involved here. The talk that she gave is lazy. He goes off. The near expected profits are only $26,000. On the other hand, if he works hard, the expected profits increase to $42,000. That expected, I mean, to take into account the probability of each state of nature. That is, in one state of nature, there is a possibility of only $10,000 for you. For example, if you have a recession in Pakistan. Under the other state of nature, economic recovery, your firm can earn a lot more money since there is more aggregate demand to economic activity. So, just by way of reminder, the expected value of several possible outcomes equals the probability of each outcome times the value of that outcome. So, for example, I toss a coin and will pay you $100 if it comes up heads. If instead it turns to tails, then you will pay me. So the expected value of this game is 50% times $1 or 120. Since there is a 50% chance that the coin will come up heads, plus a 50% chance to you of losing 120 because chances are 50% different things will come up, tails. So overall, the expected value to of the game is zero. This is a third example. Notice that the probabilities of terms that are mutually exclusive have got to add up to one. In this case, either the coin turns to heads or it turns to tails. The two probabilities will add up to 100% or one if you're dealing with fractions. So, for example, in the problem for today, there is a 60% chance of both profits. Then today is lazy. And chances of high profits are 0.4. Low profits, 10,000 dollars, and high profits to you are 50,000. So in the state of nature, the today is lazy. Then this expected value to you, the employer, is 60% times 10,000. Plus 40% of 50,000 votes. Or 6,000 to 20,000, or $26,000 overall. Now, if today is not lazy, hard-working, then the expected value now is 20% times 10,000 plus 80% times 50,000. Or 2,000 plus 1,000 42,000 overall. So clearly, as the employer, the different brother has $42,000, then to have to settle for only $36,000. But for today, the only difference between the two outcomes is that if you work hard, people lose $1,000 worth of utility. That is, now today is being paid the same amount of money, whether it was hard or not. If it was hard, people lose being lazy. $1,000 worth of disutility. So, since he can choose whether to work hard or not, he is not being monitored. So they will choose to be lazy. And their profits, their expected profits will fall to $26,000. Okay, on the basic problem. Notice that the probabilities of the two outcomes add up to 100%. So the basic problem is that Sergey has no incentive to work hard, since his salary is the same in other cases. So to offer Sergey some share of the profits that will ensure that he works hard rather than goofs off. So let's see what is involved in this. You can offer today a fraction x of the profits in other moves. That is laziness or hard working. Industriousness. So the question now for you to consider for a couple minutes is what fraction F will ensure that today will choose to work hard rather than otherwise. So just for 2 points of extra credit, just take a couple of minutes to think about this problem, and then we will solve it as a class. The first person to come up with a good answer can earn an additional 2 points of extra credit. Okay, two or 3 minutes, and then we will reconvene. Okay, let's see how we did. What are your suggestions for providing an incentive to today? So let's see. We want that fraction of profits that will ensure that today works hard. In other words, let's choose X in such a way that the value should be of working hard, the expected value will be greater than the expected cost. First of all, the opportunity cost of working hard, if those teachers have had taken the lazy instead. This is S. Says $26,000. His share of the profit is an expectation that he is lazy. Plus $1,000 of disability that he will certainly incur if he is working hard. So this is choose X in such a way that debt share of expected profits from business one would be greater than the expected cost of working hard. That expected cost, as we have just seen, is X times $56,000. Plus $1,000 in dollars of expected of certain disability. So now let us solve for X. Subtract F $26,000 to the other side. And now, let us solve to X. In the present, we have a difference of $15,000. So, now solve to X. It should be greater than 1,000 divided by 15,000. Which equals 116. A bit more than 6%. So, if you will, guarantee for today, a share of the profits of more than 150 today will choose to the part. Assuming that he cares about expected value, maybe because he is risk neutral. And then there's the solution to that problem. Is the intuition clear that you want to offer today a large enough share of the profit that he will choose to work hard despite the disability involved? So there is this assembly of the problem. Now, a question for you, maybe to consider at home for exercise tomorrow. Is this, suppose that the expected profit from either event is $36,000, and that today, then the survey suffered disability of just $1,000 if you put hard. Then what share of profit do you offer now? The expected profit that today is busy or hardworking is $36,000 in either case. Good for 1 point of extra credit into model. So let's take a look as a problem of insurance. You have a home on the river, very scenic, but also from time to time very wet. Even only a moderate flood can destroy your house. Moderate flood occurred every 50 years. Now, if you go to the expense of building a sea wall, you do not have to worry about moderate flooding. The sea wall will protect you from that small flood. However, a very large flood can still destroy your house and approach the seawall at the same time. The heavy floods occur only once every 200 years. So now there are a series of questions that you can consider for a flood insurer who is in a competitive industry. First, what is the annual premium for a flood policy that is 100% protection of your study. That's what is opinion if the policy pays not 100% of the home value, but only 75%. So if you want to take a couple of minutes to think about those two problems, the premium for 100% insurance and the premium for 75% insurance. About 1 minute, 1 to 2 minutes, and then we will reconvene. If, as always, an additional point of extra credit for the first good answer. Okay, so how did you do? What is the premium charged by a competitive insurer for 100%? Insurance. Well, notice that the insurer is not able to make a profit on the premium. If he attempts a profit, he will be undercut by a rival. So the premium must equal the expected cost of the insurance. That is the minimum that the insurer can charge to avoid an expected loss. Given 100% insurance, in other words, insurance that will pay the full cost of the house. The expected cost of insurance for the insurer is the probability of spreading first, the extent of that flood. So what is this? Well, there is a probability of another sun once every 50 years. And there is a probability of a heavy flood once every 200 years. Either a moderate or a heavy flood can destroy your house. So the probability of flooding is 1 out of 50, or 2%, just 1 out of 200, or 0.005, 0.5%. In either case, for either flood, the cost is the loss of the $400,000 house. Whether the flood is moderate or heavy. So the expected cost of these floods is 0.025, the probability of a flood. So the expense of either flood was $400,000. The expected cost of a 100% insurance that is insured that will pay for all $400,000 of home damage. The expected cost is $10,000. So if the insurer will charge a premium of $10,000. Now, if instead we have not 100% insurance, but instead 75% insurance, then the premium, of course, will go down. Again, the probability of flooding is 2.5%. And again, the cost is the loss of a $400,000 house, but now the insurer will make good not on all $400,000, but instead on only 3/4, 75% of that amount. So under 75% insurance, the expected cost to the insurer is 10,000 times 3/4. Or $7,500. And that is the premium that people charge the homeowner. Okay, so far. on how to approach this problem. Then the next question for you to consider tonight for our discussion tomorrow is whether the homeowner has an incentive to build a seed wall at his own expense in order to avoid moderate flooding. And then eventually, should the government insure 100% against all flooding, given the incentive to build a sea wall? But the way 100% insurance against flooding to homeowners is the normal case around the world for flood insurance, especially in the United States.